were in just a few months ago, Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. We're going to land the plane, as one pastor calls it, here on this series today. A couple of weeks ago, we started talking about why give, and we talked about first week, why give? Because God owns it all. It's all His. It's not shady for Him to tell us to do what to do with His stuff. All of our stuff, everything in our bank accounts, everything in our homes belongs to Him. It's all His. And then last week we talked about why give? Well, because it is an expression of our love for Him. That not the need can't move us ultimately to where we need to be, and not simply a sense of duty can move us to where we need to be. We give out of a sense of love for Him and gratitude for what He has done for us. This is why we give. But the question today before us is going to be, well, what does it practically do? And we're going to talk about that today. If you have that with me, Philippians chapter 1, go ahead and stand with me. We're going to be reading verses 3 down through verses 7. Philippians chapter 1, like I said, we preached on this a few months ago. Philippians chapter 1, starting in verse 3. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always offering prayer with joy in my every prayer for you all, in view of your participation in the gospel from the first day until now. For I'm confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. For it is only right for me to feel this way about you, because I have you all in my heart, since both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you all are partakers of grace with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, and we ask now through your word proclaimed, you would do your work in our hearts. And we ask for this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. So we've started off with questions the past couple of weeks. And so one of the questions that we often have when it comes to giving things is, what is this money doing? Where is it going? So, I don't know, maybe you were watching something this Christmas season, saw a whole lot of commercials like this during Christmas season this year. It's a very popular commercial. I remember growing up and seeing a whole lot of commercials like this. You see a child maybe who's sick, maybe it's a child who's malnourished, and here comes a ministry or an organization that's, hey, we're going to help these children that don't have enough food to eat, or we're going to help these children that need medical attention. And we see that in the images on the screen and the things that are being said. They pull at our heartstrings, and once the commercial's over there, our brain begins to think, though, how much of that money is actually going to go to those children? How much of this stuff is actually going to reach them? I mean, is it going to actually help? That sounds great. If it's going to go help, I'm totally for that. Or is this going to just line somebody's pockets? Is this just going and putting somebody in a bigger office in New York? Is that what's going on here? And those same types of thoughts happen when we come to church and we start talking about giving. Well, where are we giving? And where is it going? And what does it actually do? Now, Pastor, I know that this pays your salary, and I know we can turn the lights on, and that's great, and that's important and all, but is my giving really doing anything? And in fact, if it is, what's it doing? What does it do? And today we're going to answer that. And we're going to answer that in part by taking a look at what Paul said to the Philippians here. And what we're going to see is this simple principle. When you give, you participate in gospel ministry. When we give, we participate in ministry. We see this principle here in this passage. Paul praying and thanking God for the Philippians there in verse 3. And he tells them in verse 5, the Philippians, he tells them why he's giving thanks for them. Notice with me, in view of your participation in the gospel from the first day until now. Now that word participation, if you'll remember back in October, we talked about this. That word literally is the Greek word koinonia. If you've been in church at all, you've probably heard of that term. We often translate koinonia, fellowship. And often when we say fellowship, here's what we think of. We think of like punch and cookies. Cheese and crackers. All right, awesome. We think of, you know, something like that. We're getting together for a fellowship afterwards, okay? That's what we think of. But fellowship is not necessarily a social gathering like that. Fellowship, if you remember, is a partnering together in something. Fellowship is being together in a movement together, or if you will, being business partners in a venture together. We share a stake in this same thing together. These are people that have fellowship together. We have fellowship around the gospel. We have fellowship, just like Paul did with the Philippians in the gospel, in view of their fellowship, in terms of their participation in the gospel. Now, that takes a little bit of explaining. What does that mean, real quick? Well, I think it means at least three things for us today. Number one, it means that the Philippians knew Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Paul went to Philippi, shared the gospel. These people came to know Jesus Christ. That is the exact same mission that we are about here. Bar nothing. We are about sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with the nations, that there is a God. And even though our minds might not be able to grasp all of who he is because he is infinite, he is there. And every single one of us, the Bible tells us, has sinned against him. We've gone our own way. We've done our own thing. We've not honored him as God. We've not given thanks to him the way that we ought to have. And because God is just, he will judge our sin, and we are guilty. The gospel is this, that God not only is just, at the same time as he is just, he is loving. He is loving and just. He is both. And sent his Son, God the Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross as the perfect atoning sacrifice for your sin and for mine, to give that to us as a free gift. Not something that we go earn. Not something that we can kind of pay off after a while. No, no, no. Something he gives to us as a gift. To whoever wants it. Whoever wants to can come back into a right relationship with the God, where he's God and we're not, and we follow him because he's God and he knows what's up and I don't. I can come back into that relationship with him because of what Jesus Christ has purchased for me. This is what we mean by being saved. That we are saved from our sin and from our guilt before a holy God. And he counts us as righteous, not because of what we do, but because of what Jesus Christ has done for us on the cross. The Bible tells us that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. We receive that as a gift. We trust Jesus to do this for us, that he is our Savior and our Lord. The Philippians believed in Jesus Christ, became partakers, fellowshippers with Paul in the gospel. When you became a believer, you became a partaker. You became one who fellowships with other believers in the gospel because you know Jesus Christ. This is our mission, to share what God has done for us around the world. Because apart from Jesus Christ, there is no life. There is no life and no hope. Not only this does Paul mean this when he talks about being fellowshippers in the gospel together, but they participated with him, they have fellowship together. He also means that they're sharing the gospel in their local context. So they're going out into Philippi like we're called out to go into Norman and share the gospel. Now, not only this, not only are they doing that, but there's one way in particular when you read all the way through Philippians and you read it as a whole, you begin to pick up on. Philippians, if you didn't know, is one big, gigantic thank you letter. It's what it is. It's a thank you letter to the Lord, but also to the Philippians. You know why? Because they had monetarily supported Paul. And so when he talks about, this is his thank you letter for their gift, when he talks about their participation in the gospel, he's talking about that they know Christ. He's talking about that they're sharing the gospel in their context, but he's also talking about, you have come here and sent this gift to me. You are helping me in my ministry. You are participating in my ministry with me. You see that down in verse 7, that they were with him in his imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. Well, how are they doing that if he's in prison in Rome or in Caesarea and there in Philippi? Because they gave. And through their giving, they were participants in his ministry. When we give, we participate in gospel ministry. In the New Testament, when believers gave, they gave for four reasons, to support four things. If you're a note taker, there are four M's. So just write four different M's on your sheet of paper there, on the back of your bulletin there. Ministry and missions, they didn't always separate them. Teaching and going, or growing and going ministries, if you will. Meeting needs, and paying for their ministers, helping support them so they can share the gospel full time. When you give here, you support those exact same things. The same things New Testament believers gave to. Okay, Pastor, that sounds great. That sounds wonderful. But I want to know, like, what is it doing? Like, practically, real world. I'd love to share that with you today. Number one, when you give, your giving supports local ministries here through Bethel. Now, this is just a listing of some of the ministries that we have, so don't be like, oh, well, you left this ministry off, you left that ministry off. I couldn't put all of our ministries up here. We'd have multiple slides, and we'd be just shifting those slides the rest of the service, okay? And nobody would enjoy that. So here's just some of the ministries that we are doing. Things like our children's ministry, our youth ministry, our college ministry, our women's ministry, men's ministry, senior adult ministry, our local mission projects, like our block party, like our ESL class. And so sharing Christ with our neighborhood, sharing Christ with the nations, that's what we're doing here. So practically, in terms of like our children's ministry, when you give, you are helping participate and support things like, well, like Vacation Bible School that's coming up in about 3 months. We won't want to simply minister simply to our own kids, but also to the kids around our church, the kids in Norman. We've been given a worldwide mission. He's placed us here. This is where we're to make an impact. And so we want to make an impact for the kids, especially right around our church. When you give, you help make VBS a reality. Now, Kim would want me to say this as well. Giving isn't the only way. Nobody can sit here and say, oh, well, I give so I don't have to help out with VBS this year. Okay, no. We don't want to go that direction either, okay? We want to be giving and we want to be going. We want to be sharing and we want to be serving. We need to be doing both. But when you give, you are helping support ministries like this. You're helping support ministries like our after-school Wednesday night program going on over at the Annex for our middle school kids. Not just our middle school kids, but from the two middle schools real close to there, Whittier and Alcott. Many of those students have come to know Christ through this. Some students getting baptized tonight, or excuse me, this morning over in the Annex. We're going to see that video next week. Came to know Christ, as I understand, through this ministry, our youth ministry. Guess what? When you gave, that means you participated in that ministry. You had a hand in seeing that child come to know Christ. You helped make that happen by your giving. You're not the only one that did this. You're not the only thing that happened over there. You're not the only way that that happened, but you are part of it, and you help make that happen. And just in case you don't understand this, we don't receive any money from like government or the state. We don't receive any money like that. All of our operating budget comes off of what we give, you and me, what we give each week in our offering. That's That's where our operating money comes from. That's how we do this ministry. And that's the only place our money comes from. And so when you give, in reality, you are helping Bethel Baptist Church carry out its mission of loving God, loving people, and making disciples. You, in a very tangible, real-world, practical way, are touching every single sphere of ministry that we have in our church by giving. And so I want to encourage you to do that. Now, most churches that we have, you know, in the United States could probably say that same thing. Well, we got this ministry, and we got that ministry, and that's good. I'm glad they have those ministries. But here's the great thing about being a Southern Baptist, and one of the things I love so much about it. When we have all these things going on in our church, one of the things that we can say is, well, this isn't where our giving and what we do, it's not where it stops. This is just where it begins. When you give, it begins here. But it doesn't stop here. It goes on around our entire state. Take a look at the screen with me. When you give, it supports statewide ministries. We participate in what is known as the cooperative program. We ask all of our church members to tithe. Our church tithes. We don't operate on 100% of our budget. We give away 10% off the top of what we make to the cooperative program. Why would we do that? Because it helps carry out ministries around our state, and as we're going to hear in just a moment, around our nation and around our world. What are some of those ministries around our state? Again, this is just a smattering of them. It can't possibly encapsulate all of them, but here's some of them. You help support Falls Creek, that wonderful place maybe for you when you were growing up. You maybe came to know Christ there. We have students every year that come to know Christ at Falls Creek. And you, when you give, because we give to the cooperative program, help make Falls Creek happen each and every year. And if our churches simply decided to stop giving, and if our members decided to stop giving, not only would our churches begin to fade away in terms of what we could do monetarily, it would also fade things like Falls Creek out. You help make Falls Creek a reality. Those students, those thousands of students that came to know Christ last year, if you gave regularly to our, you know, you gave tithes and offerings, you helped have a hand in that. You participated in that. Those students called to special ministry, God used Falls Creek to call them to special ministry. Guess what? You had a hand in that. You had a hand in making that happen. Doesn't only stop there. We've got ministries like Day Spring Villa. Most people do not realize this. As Americans, we think that slavery died after the Civil War. No, it did not. In fact, there is a very clear and very dangerous form of it that goes on today. I saw an article over the past 2 weeks of a huge sting that took place down in Houston during the Super Bowl. Type of modern-day slavery that goes on today is known as human trafficking. Sex slavery, where young girls and young women are taken from their families, some of them stolen from their families, forced into a life of prostitution. Day Spring Villa exists to help battered women and also women coming out of sex slavery have a safe place where they can hide and they can be safe. If you're a man, by the way, it's in Tulsa, but you will never know where Day Spring Villa is, and that's a good thing. I don't know where it is. You don't need to know. Our ladies need to know, but you don't. This exists because you give. I want to be helping make a practical difference. Then give, because this is one of the ministries we help support as Southern Baptists here in Oklahoma. You help support disaster relief. You remember the ice apocalypse that didn't happen a few weeks ago? Woohoo! Guess where it did happen? Woodward. And it was bad. It was really bad. And you know what happened that next day? It hit Saturday, Sunday. On Monday, we had a man from our church get a crew of other men from Oklahoma and head out to Woodward to serve. You know why? Because we as Southern Baptists help support disaster relief. Disaster relief is an organization that helps basically take care of people that have been hit with disasters, whether that's hurricanes or that's tornadoes or whether that's ice storms. They go, they have chainsaw crews, they have food trucks, they go help take care of people that are in dire situations. This is a helping ministry meeting real practical needs and offers an opportunity to share the gospel. And if you give regular tithes and offerings, you help support that ministry. It's what you do. It's where this money goes. Because of what our church does with our money, because of what you have chosen as a church, here's what we're going to do with our money. You help support things like Baptist homes for children. Children needing to be placed in foster care, not because of what they've done, but because of their family situation. So they're pulled out of their family, and they are scared, and they feel alone, and everything is just crazy now in their lives, and they need a place that's going to be safe. They need a place where they're going to be clothed and have food, and they're going to be kept warm and dry, and they're going to have a place where they can get education, and we would hope a place that they can hear about Christ. Guess what? We have a place like that. Our Baptist homes for children. And you help support that with your tithes and offerings. You may not know that we've done, but this is what you're doing. This is one of the things that you are involved in. When you give your tithes and offerings, it's one of the ministries you, not only are helping support, you are helping participate in through your tithes and offerings here. You help support ministries like OBU, my alma mater, Go Bison. And so I'm not going to make us go with Corrip today, so don't worry. So, yes. And so one of the neat things about OBU, perhaps you heard this from Will Smallwood. I love saying it anyway. The number one university that the International Mission Board, the mission sending arm, foreign mission sending arm of the Southern Baptist Convention, by the way, we're going to talk about them in a minute because we support them too. They say the number one university through which they get most of their missionaries, OBU. Our 2,000 student Baptist university, just an hour from us over in Shawnee. Not here with the 30,000 student at OU. Nothing bad about OU and nothing bad about the ministries that are going on here, nothing like that. I'm just saying more come from OBU than anywhere else. And you have a hand in that. You have a hand in that through your tithes, through your offerings. You have a hand in this. So capture this picture with me. When you tithe, you help support Falls Creek, the largest Christian encampment in the world, where God led many of these students to know Christ, many of these students into special ministry, just a call into special ministry. They then went to OBU, which you also helped make happen through your tithes and through your offerings. And then God placed them on the mission field. Why? Because you were faithful to give. People, you don't even know their name, and you will never know their name. You might not know where they're serving. But you helped make that happen. Do you think that's just an accident that we happen to have the largest Baptist encampment and the most students going to the IMB from our Baptist school? Do you think that's just an accident that happens? No, it's not. God has seen fit to use these things for his glory, and that happens because you give. Thank you for giving and being a part of this. But again, this is not where it ends. This is, again, just where it starts. Because the cooperative program not only goes around our state, it goes around our nation and our world. When you give, you support national and international ministries. You support international ministries like the International Mission Board. We just spoke about them. This is the foreign mission sending arm of the Southern Baptist Convention. So over 4,000 Southern Baptist missionaries are serving around the globe right now. You're going to meet one of them in 2 weeks. His name is Luke Cavo. He's going to be here on Sunday morning and on Sunday evening. He's going to get to say a few things Sunday morning. He's going to preach the whole time Sunday evening, talk about his ministry. You're going to have a time to meet him, have a little bit of Q&A with him. And so, but he's going to be here. You're going to get to meet one of these missionaries that you help support, one of these 4,000 missionaries that you help support and you help put on the field. They're in India. He told me the other week he got to stop by. They're on furlough here since Christmas. They're hoping to head back in early April. He told me, you know, Matt, the biggest need we have is for good, solid Bible teaching for these Christians here. Because you know where they're getting most of their teaching? They're getting most of their teaching through the DVD ministries of most of the health and wealth teachers that you have here in America. Because so many people are throwing money at these false religions. These people that are not teaching the gospel, that are teaching something that aligns more with like Harry Potter-esque type stuff. Just say the right words and God has to. No, that's not the gospel. That's not scripture. They need good, solid gospel teaching. And we are sending men like Luke, who is training other men who are then training other men to do this good, solid gospel teaching. We're going to learn about more ways we can be involved in that in 2 weeks. But when you give, you help support ministries like Luke's, sharing the gospel properly with people over in India. You are helping put him on the field when you give. We support our North American Mission Board, which is the mission board that sends things over United States and Canada. And so to these two nations, most people don't realize this, one of the most unchurched nations in the world is the United States. And so we need to remember, we can't just sit back and take it easy and, oh, isn't it great to be an American? Yes, it is great to be an American. We also need to realize that we are called to share the gospel with the rest of America. So we can't just sit back and take it easy. There are many people in our own nation that do not know Jesus Christ, and we need to share with them. North American Mission Board is helping do that, placing planters, church planters, placing missionaries, helping place pastors into local contexts that are mostly unreached with the gospel, often in highly urban areas. You are having ministries in places like Baltimore and Cleveland and Cincinnati and Nashville, places like Phoenix and Los Angeles and Seattle, places maybe you've never been and only heard about, but you, when you give, are helping support ministries there, and you are participating in their ministries. Not only that, you're helping support our Southern Baptist seminaries. Here's the very practical way that works. As a person who went to a Southern Baptist seminary for many, many, many years, let me tell you what it does. It takes my what I was paying in tuition and cuts it in half. So I didn't pay $5,000. I paid $2,500 because you gave. I've talked with a lot of parents, and I haven't heard any parents have college-age children. We're getting pretty close to there ourselves. I haven't heard any parents that are looking at that and going, man, the cost of higher education is so affordable these days. It's just amazing how inexpensive it is. No, no, no. Those costs keep rising. It's usually the other way around, isn't it? Oh, my goodness. And when you pick yourself up off the floor, then you start having that conversation. And so you help make theological education for pastors and missionaries possible. And help make it economically feasible by giving your regular tithes and offerings here. I want to show you a graphic real quickly. Just as our church, we ask our church members to tithe, our church tithes and gives away 10% of what we get. The BGCO tithes, but they don't give 10%. They give 40. And they give 40 to the cooperative program of the SBC. And here's where that money goes. That red portion of the heart up there, you can see 73.20% goes to World Missions. That's the International Mission Board. That's the North American Mission Board. So we heard about those just a moment ago. The blue portion of the heart right there, that real vibrant light blue color, theological education ministry, that means seminaries and our libraries and archives, a very small percentage of that goes to our libraries and archives. The vast majority of that, 21.92%, goes to help our seminary students. So if you're just taking a look at that, 95% of the money that you give that goes to our state and then goes through our state, that 40% that goes over to the BG or the SBC, goes to help place missionaries on the field or helps train them to then be placed on the field, to help train pastors to be on the field. You, when you give, are helping share the name of Christ around the world. you are helping in a very tangible, practical, real-world way when you give the name of Christ go everywhere around this globe. You're helping ministries go on here in Norman. You're helping ministries go on in our state. You're helping ministries go on in our nation. You're helping ministries go on around our world. Now, real quickly, as a short little aside, real quickly, I do know that I've talked with several people in our church. There is a little bit of a brouhaha over the Christian Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission there. That's the 1.65 at the very, very bottom. It's the real dark, real slight sliver right there on the point there of the heart. Very, very small. And so Russell Moore has said some things that are just difficult, quite honestly, and not always everything that every Southern Baptists agree with. And so there's kind of a brouhaha. I heard something this past week of a big, very large, very influential church in Texas that's decided, you know what we're going to do? We're just going to withhold our money until they can figure out what's going on with the Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission. Let me tell you what I think on that. Take a look at the numbers up there. Just take a look at those percentages. Even if you just take the world ministry and the theological education ministries, you've got more than 95%. If you take all of it, including what goes on with the operating budget for the SBC, 98% of what we do as a Southern Baptist Convention. And they are putting all of that. Missionaries, they're putting ministers in training at our seminaries, they're putting the SBC as a whole, they're putting ministries and stuff going on here in our nation on hold, until we figure out what's going on with the 1%. That's ridiculous. We should not starve the 98% for the 1.65%. This is absolutely wrong. We should cooperate together. Should we figure out what's going on there? Yes. Should we bring that back in a direction we want? Yes, absolutely. But we should not simply withhold. That sets, in my mind and my heart, a very bad precedent. When you give, you are participating in ministry. When you give, you're helping put missionaries on the field into closed countries, countries we can't go into officially as missionaries. But we're going in anyway. And you're helping place those missionaries there. When you give, you help make Falls Creek a place where our students can have life-changing experiences with Christ. When you give, you are helping students at OBU and at our 6 Southern Baptist seminaries. When you give, you are helping fund Day Spring Villa and helping battered women and those seeking to escape sex slavery. When you give here, you are helping place missionaries into very unreached parts of our own nation. When you give, you are helping a ministry here, our ESL ministry, take place to people that need to know Christ here. When you give, you are making Vacation Bible School a reality for a student that right now, today, does not know Jesus Christ. But come June, she will. Come June, he will. Why? Because you helped give and helped support that ministry. And so I want to land the plane here on this. We've already taken up our offering today, so I'm not trying to dig more money out of you, okay? So, I mean, that's one of the reasons we moved it. I want you to go home and I want you to pray. If you are not already giving, I don't want to beat you over the head with this. I don't want to, you know, beat you with a rubber hose or anything like that during this. What I want to do is I want to encourage you to join us in gospel ministry, because when you give, you are helping participate, not just fund, but participate in ministry. This is what we're doing as a church right now, already. We don't have to line anything up to make this happen. This is what is happening today with the money that people already gave. If you will, I want you to be a part of this with us. Will you participate with us in sharing the gospel around the world? In Malachi 3, God tells his people, test me in this. Just test me. In fact, it's really kind of funny he says that, because through the rest of the Bible says, don't ever test the Lord. Jesus even said that in his temptations. It said, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. You should never put the Lord to a place where you're like, you know, I don't know if he's going to be faithful. I don't know if he will. I don't know if he won't. Let's just test it and see if he will. God says, don't you ever put me to the test, except in this situation. This one situation, put me to the test. See if I will. Guess what that situation is? Tithing and God providing for our needs. So we can go into, I don't know. I don't know if it's going to work. I don't know. Test him and see. He said you could. I want to invite you this month. Tithe this month. Let's just see what God will do in your life. Let's just see what God will do in the life of our church if we tithe this month. He said we could test him and see. He said he would provide. He said he owns it all. We can give this as a love offering to him, and we know it goes around the globe to make difference, a difference for his name. Let's give. Will you participate with us? Let's pray. You respond today. Jesus, we thank you so much for today. I want to pray for